I Googled that question, and on the first page of articles, the suggestions went from 122 to 35,000. Obviously, the researchers had different criteria for what constitutes a decision. We make decisions without even realizing because they become reflexive. For example, hitting the snooze button when our alarm clock rings. We also make decisions that don't seem like decisions because they have become habitual. For example, making coffee in the morning or going for a run before breakfast. I also gleaned from several synopses of articles that we spend a lot of time deciding what to eat. We also change our minds about our decisions a lot. We look to others to help us make our decisions. And wisdom and honesty are the characteristics we look for in determining who we ask to help us make our decisions. Every one of us has gone through a series of decisions before we decided to spend this hour sitting in the sanctuary this morning. Not all of our decisions in a day are life-altering, but daily decisions can have a cumulative effect in our identity formation. We begin our scripture readings this morning with God speaking to the prophet Jeremiah concerning God's decision about the fate of Israel. God uses an illustration common to daily life in ancient Israel, a potter making a clay pot, to reveal the thoughts behind God's decision-making process. The theological tension between God's omnipotent authority and human free will is played out using this metaphor of God as the master potter and Israel as the clay. When the potter isn't happy with the product made on the potter's wheel, the choice is to either throw away the pot or reform the clay into a new pot. Thus, the clay can be interpreted on one level as being Israel, but on another level as being God's mind. God's vision of the pot changes with the decision to form a new pot. A pot must be useful to the potter. If it's defective, it will not be useful to the potter's purpose in creating it. God's decision to scrap the defective pot is the potter's prerogative, as is the decision to reform the clay. The clay has no power to determine its own fate. However, the clay can dry out and become less malleable, making it more likely that the potter will scrap the pot. If Israel is interpreted as the malleability of the clay, she can submit to the potter's hand and participate in her own reformation. But if the clay is interpreted as God's own mind and will, the metaphor becomes about the freedom of the potter to make the decision to start over. God's decision to rework the clay allows Israel to make the decision to submit to God's authority and will, or continue her own path that leads to destruction. This is God's word to the people of what is left at this point of the former nation of Israel. This past week, we heard our president say in a speech that this country is at a similar crossroads in decision-making. Do we continue as a democracy or not? Many individual and group decisions have been made to get us to the present reality of our political division of purpose and process. That cumulative effect of decisions has changed who we are as a nation and how the rest of the world perceives us. If we perceive our nation as being under God, that is, submitting to God's authority above all others, we have a tremendous responsibility to be reformed back into God's intentions for a just and peaceful nation, regardless of political party affiliation. The epistle reading for today sounds like a personal letter, but it's really a public letter. Paul uses a deceptive ploy to persuade Philemon to do the right thing. The letter was written to be read to the whole congregation of the church that met in Philemon's house. We know that Philemon was a wealthy man because he had a house big enough for a group of Christians to congregate on the Sabbath. And he had slaves. The eyes of the congregation would have been watching Philemon, who Paul had placed in the proverbial hot seat. Paul's letter is both diplomatic and cleverly persuasive. He makes a pun on Onesimus' name, which means useful, by putting forth the argument that Onesimus will be more useful to Christ's mission if Philemon allows him to return to Paul than if he remains a slave in Philemon's household. Paul acknowledges that Philemon has already suffered financial loss during the time that Onesimus had run away. Paul magnanimously agrees to cover Philemon's losses, but slyly reminds Philemon that he owes his very life to Paul for bringing him to Christ. Philemon must decide whether to choose forgiveness and Christ's mission for his disciples or his own revenge and economic gain. Paul is thus informing Philemon that Christian discipleship has a cost, which is also Jesus' point in his speech to an enthusiastic crowd that has come to hear him speak. This crowd that appears as the audience in our gospel reading from Luke is a Palm Sunday crowd. Jesus is on his journey to the cross, but the crowd doesn't realize that. It is a crowd who wants change and sees Jesus as a man who might be able to do that for them. The great preacher Fred Craddock described the crowd as representing the tension between Galilee and Jerusalem, peasants versus power, laity versus clergy, Jews versus Romans, Jesus versus the establishment. Jesus doesn't say, "Come with me and I'll fix these problems you're dealing with." Jesus tells them to stop and think what they are asking and consider the cost they are willing to pay to change the world Jesus' way, to become useful disciples for God's kingdom. Jesus goes for shop talk when he addresses the crowd. Whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. Hate your family? That doesn't sound biblical. And it isn't. Hate your life? Is he talking about self-loathing? Suicide, even? That isn't biblical either. Here, Jesus is using the word hate as a commonly used Semitic hyperbole. In this context, hate means to love less or to detach oneself from. Here, Jesus is saying that following him is more important than anything else. In truth, many modern families have come to idolize their families. Parents will go to great lengths to give their children a boost on the ladder to worldly success. Sometimes, parents' decisions form themselves and their children according to their own desires and decide not to put following Christ first. For example, if you believe being together for recreation on Sunday morning is a higher priority than being together for recreation at Sunday morning worship, you have made a decision that affects who you are and who you are teaching your children to be. Putting yourself second to God is a biblical commandment. Humility is the proper approach to God, but not to the point of devaluing yourself. The Bible tells us we are made in God's image, that we are beautifully and wondrously made. Here, Jesus is saying, if you love yourself more than God, you will not be a disciple who is useful in God's kingdom. Jesus includes two parables as illustrations, then ends with another frightening cost of discipleship. Again, Jesus is speaking in hyperbole. Give away all your possessions? That's a pretty difficult demand. What Jesus is telling these would-be disciples is that if you love your possessions more than you love God, you cannot be Christ's disciple. Throughout all the scriptures, there is a consistent message. Anything you love more than God is your God. Jesus was putting the pressure on his audience, and now us, that being a disciple must have a cost to us, or it is not true discipleship. Jesus told the crowd that to be his disciples, they had to carry the cross. He didn't say everyone had to die on it. He knew he would be the one to pay that price, and it was the cost God and Jesus was willing to endure for us. To carry the cross is to see discipleship through to the end, not to dabble in discipleship when it is convenient, but the very times when it isn't. We may not be asked to sacrifice our physical lives, but we are asked to give up ourselves as the center of the universe and center ourselves in relation to God. We are also asked to give up our illusions that we are the potter, when in truth we are the clay. It is God who has formed and continues to form us. When we resist, we are still a clay pot, but one that is so far from the potter's design that we are useless vessels. So where's the payoff we all want for our efforts? Jesus wants disciples who are willing to keep lifting the cross high, because this is how transformation comes. This is how we become the new creations that God calls us to be. Jeremiah's harsh warnings also came with comforting assurance. No matter what travails the world brings that would break us, God the potter can reshape us as useful vessels of divine love. If we seek help in our decisions to be disciples from the one who is wise and trustworthy, our decisions can become reflexive and habitual, making the decision-making process involved simply a part of our being as Christian disciples. With repentance, turning toward the giver of life and all good gifts, God, the potter, will reshape us into Christ's image. And so we come to Christ's table. Here we come to be reformed. We come with hope that the world can be made a better place, more like God's kingdom. We come to share with one another the love that Christ shared at his table. Amen. May it be so.